is on a playoff roll and doesn't plan on finishing second. The Broncos of Lombard Montini go for their first ever state title. The 4A championship game is next. And welcome to Memorial Stadium. We're just a couple of moments away from the Class 4A state championship game between the Broncos of Montini and the Kohlers of Coal City. Two games have already been finished. The 1A game most recently done. Your winner there, Alexis United over Stockton. The first game of the day, Newman Catholic, a winner over Carthage. Hey, this shapes up to be a dandy of a game, but let's talk to the two guys, or actually listen to the two guys who are going to bring you the call of the game and know plenty about these two teams, that being Lee Hall and Greg Bradshaw. Guys, take it away.
All right, Mike, thank you very much. We're ready for 4A state championship football here at Memorial Stadium. Lee Hall and Greg Bradshaw, and we think we're going to see a pretty good ball game here between teams coached by veteran coaches, both coaching their alma maters in Lombard Montini and Coal City.
We should have a good football game. We have two contrasting styles here. We've got Montini, that's an offensively explosive ball club, a lot of big plays. On the flip side, you've got Coal City, and that one word that describes them is defense. They're interested in controlling the football and letting their defense stop the other team.
Coal City coming off a 22-0 win at home over Quincy Notre Dame. They completely shut down the Raiders. There's their road to Champaign, a shutout win over Dunlap in game one. They beat Mendota 38-7. Revenge against Prairie Central, the team that knocked them out a year ago and went on to the state championship game. And, of course, as we mentioned, they beat Quincy Notre Dame last weekend at home. For Lombard Montini, they beat St. Francis of Wheaton 33-0 in round one. Burlington Central 25-13. Marion of Woodstock, they beat them for the second time this year. And then a win at home over Heron from Southern Illinois 28-11 to make it to the first state championship in the lengthy career of head coach Chris Andriano.
Yeah, they're excited to be here. One of the three teams today, out of 16 teams today and tomorrow in all these championships, only three, it's their first time, Montini being one of them. They're very excited. They're looking forward to a great game today.
Let's take a look at some of the key players. First, for the visitors from Coal City, the Kohlers, and Jeff Hodgen is one heck of a quarterback.
Yeah, he is. He's big, strong, and physical. It's critical for him today. He's going to have to make some big plays for them to win this game. They're going to try to ball control, but I look for him to do some play action passing and to go deep and try to hit the home run.
Defensively for the Kohlers, our key player,
it's Matt Watson. Matt, 6'3", 240. You'll see him on the offensive side of the ball carrying it at fullback, but also on defense. He's going to be responsible for stopping these two great running backs from Montini.
Now let's take a look at Montini, our key player offensively for them, the All-Stater, Mike Mucha.
This guy can run the football. Not only is he strong and does a great job after the first hit and getting extra yards, he has some breakaway speed. So look for him to make some huge plays today for the Montini team.
And on defense, it's Marty Hyland, defensive end.
He's only a junior. Look at that bottom stat there. 28 sacks. It's unbelievable. We thought it was a misprint, but after talking to the coach, this kid is all over the field. He's going to be on Hodgen today. They need him to get pressure on the quarterback.
All right. There you have our key players for today's game. 4A state championship, a couple of 12-1 teams. Coal City taking on Montini High School out of Lombard. Let's go to our public address announcer for today's ball game, Jeff Fritzen, for the starting lineups.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, here are the starting lineups for the Class 4A state championship football game. First, the defense from Montini High School. At end, number 78, Matt Gertler. At tackle, number 66, Joe Vasquez. At tackle, number 60, Jimmy Rierma. At end, number 29, Marty Hyland. At linebacker, number 9, Steve Erlenbaugh. At linebacker, number 50, Joe Davis. At linebacker, number 35, Brad Blackwell. At defensive back, number 30, Matt Neustadt. At defensive back, number 1, Pat Lyons. At defensive back, number 32, Joey Borsellino. And the defensive back, number 33, Mike Mucha. The Broncos are coached by Chris Andriano. And now the starting offense for the Coal City Kohlers. A tight end, number 40, Sean Brooks. A tackle, number 74, Stephen Miller. At guard, number 53, Nick Benarek. At center, number 65, Josh Hinkleman. At guard, number 63, Keegan Grant. At tackle, number 73, Luke Opid. At wide receiver, number 18, Nick Arndt. At quarterback, number 11, Jeffrey Hodgen. At running back, number 39, Matt Watson. At running back, number 35, Kyle Lardy. And receiver number 36, Drew Vickers. The Kohlers are coached by Lenny Onsen.
All right, there you have our starting lineups for today's 4A state championship game. Let's take a look at the keys to the game, brought to you by Mr. Greg Bradshaw.
Coal City, being a defensive ball club, they cannot allow Montini to get the big play today, which they want to do. So they've got to just make them drive the length of the field. Turnovers equals triumph. They are going to need to make Montini put the ball on the ground or pick it off in the air, because I don't think they're the kind of team that's going to be able to move the ball really consistently. They need to have a short field against Montini. And lastly, Hodgen heroics. I said it earlier. Jeff Hodgen today at quarterback's got to make some big. In Coal Cities, they need to dominate on the offensive line. Number two, touch of Murphy. Ben Murphy's a great wide receiver. They need to get him touches, whether giving it on reverses or through the air. And then lastly, they have to stop the sweep. Coal City likes to do, they like to pitch the ball outside and get it to their running backs outside on the sweep, and they need to contain that. I think we're ready to go here, Lee.
Jeff Farnell will kick it off for Montini. He takes care of the kickoff. A booming kick down inside the five. Kohlers reverse. Howard has it. And nothing doing there. KC Lieberg with the stop inside the 10-yard line. And there you get a look at where these schools are. Coal City just off of I-55 on your way north to Chicago. And Lombard right up there in the suburbs.
Not far from Joliet.
Right. My dad's car broke down on the way back from a Jimmy Buffett concert, and he had to get it repaired in Coal City. That's my Coal City story. I had never been to Coal City until the game last week. My dad had been there, though, with not very good memories. Coal City will start offensively. Hodgen under center. That's Watson in motion. Looked like the back, Lardy, might have moved early. He gets upended at the 15-yard line. And there is a flag on the play. It'll go against Coal City. Miller, Bonerick, Hinkleman, Farkas, and Luke Opid. The big fellas up front. In the backfield, it's a good quarterback, Jeffrey Hodgen. He had a whale of a game last weekend. Matt Watson and Kyle Lardy, the backs. Tight end Sean Brooks, Drew Vickers. And Nick Arndt is a very potent weapon for Jeffrey Hodgen. That was an illegal shift against Coal City. Looked like Lardy might have moved a little bit earlier. Their leading rusher, Zach Smith, has had all kinds of injury trouble in the postseason and is not in the starting lineup. He broke his thumb most recently and was on the sidelines last week with a cast. Lenny Olsen was hopeful that he would see some action today. Backs in the eye for the Kohlers. It's Lardy again. Stopped at the line, bounces off the tacklers and gets maybe a yard.
Little
Here's
chitter.
A look.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
We got to get these starters in.
Okay.
Here, partner. Matt Gertler, Joe Vasquez, Jimmy Riema, and Marty Highlane Marty Highland, Steve Erlenbaugh, Joe Davis, and Brad Blackwell, the linebackers for the Broncos, and the defensive backs, Matt Neustadt, Pat Lyons, Joey Borsellino, and Mike Mucha, the two guys in the backfield for Montini. Second down, 13 yards.
And it's passed out to Nick Arndt, who we just mentioned that he was one of Hodgins' favorite receivers. He's out to about the 12-yard line. And they'll still be about 7 yards shy of a first down.
You saw Matt Watson out there, the big fullback. They use him in a lot of different ways. They like to motion him and lead him up on a linebacker on the runs. For Lardy, or there they had him motion out to the wide receiver spot and kick out the corner for that little quick screen.
Zach Smith is on the sideline wearing a cast on that broken right thumb. The cast doesn't appear to be as big as it was last week, so the Kohlers hopeful to see him today. Third and 7 for Cole City. Hodgins back to throw. And Arndt was double covered as Hodgins throws it out of bounds. And that'll bring up fourth down for the Kohlers.
Well, he wasn't open. Jeff Hodgins did a nice job there. He wasn't open. He threw the ball out of bounds. Don't make a bad play early, particularly they are going into the wind. Don't make a bad play that would put him in the hole right to start the game here. Special teams always big when it gets cold and in the wind. Punting is always a big part of a football game in cold weather.
Ben Rouse is the punter for Cole City. And he gets off a pretty decent kick into that wind. It's Murphy with the return. He is brought down at about the 26-yard line. Ben Murphy, wide receiver, one of the return men. Only a 29-yard punt into that wind, 16-yard return. Offensive line for Montini. I'm going to have a tough time with that all day, I can tell. Montini, Jimmy Riema, Brandon Fry, Matt Bocati, Frank Gentile, and Braden Land. We'll talk about Brandon Fry later. Bobby Dobry is the quarterback, and here's his 1-2 punch in the backfield. Borsellino and Mucha. Tight end is Pat Kelly, Neil Ravain, and Ben Murphy is Dobry's favorite target when it comes to throwing the football. First and 10 at the 26-yard line for the Broncos. Dobry under center. Fakes the give, ducks under a tackler, and gets maybe a yard or two before he's brought down.
Montini's going to want to establish the run. They have these two All-State running backs in the backfield. They like to establish the run, but they will throw it when they need to.
Arndt and Watson, Brooks and Brock Martis up front for Cole City. Linebackers Bernie D'Orazio, Kyle Lardy, Corey McCullough, who is battling an ankle injury. Luke Turner, Jack Carpenter, Brian Naden, and Brandon Howard, the defensive backs. Second down and 7. Backs are split. Dobry will throw. Has a man down in the corner. A leaping grab by Murphy, I should say. But doesn't come down with it. Jack Carpenter on the coverage for the Kohlers.
Great play by Carpenter. You're going to see a lot of that today. When they want to go for the home run, they look to number 21, Ben Murphy. Murphy went up, had an opportunity to catch that ball, but a great defensive play. It's bringing up 3rd and 7.
We played almost 3 minutes here in our opening quarter of the Class 4A State Championship game. 12-1 Cole City, 12-1 Montini. 3rd and 7 for the Broncos, clad in maroon and gold. Dobry to Murphy, makes the grab, steps out of bounds. He's short of the first down.
Dobry's pass complete to number 21, Ben Murphy.
You have to take kind of a second look. A couple of these Kohler players have their shoes. Maybe it's just
short
one guy. He's got
a
yellow
four
shoes. I think that's
two.
A flag every time I look down.
Nice catch by Ben Murphy, showed his athletic ability. The ball was kind of thrown behind him. He came back to make the grab. Nice catch, giving him 4th and short.
4th and a couple. Borsellino and Mucha split in the backfield. The give is to Borsellino, and he just might have it. Looks like he does.
That was Mucha, actually.
Mucha, excuse me. They're a great 1-2 punch. Chris Andriano says it's the best backfield he's had at Montini.
And one's 217 pounds, the other one's 150. It's like David and Goliath back there.
That time it's Borsellino. And he gets a couple of hard-fought yards. down to about the 12.
It's a good test early for the Coal City defense. Montini gets the ball on the 25-yard line after that short punt and great return. Really putting the pressure here on Coal City.
Second and eight. That's Borsellino. He's brought down at the line of scrimmage. Ball on the ground. And it'll be third down. Montini gets it back. Borsellino hit hard at the line of scrimmage. Brings up third and eight.
Right now, Coal City's playing a two-deep defense. The middle of the field is wide open. If they got Montini has some coaches up in the box, I wouldn't be surprised if they look a fake in the line and try to throw the ball over the middle, right down the middle of the field.
Third and six for Montini. Dobry back to throw. He's got a man wide open. Good call, coach. Wide open. Pat Kelly for the touchdown. 11-yard strike from Dobry to Pat Kelly. Boy, those quarterbacks can spot those openings, can't they, Greg Bradshaw? Another look.
It was pretty obvious. They have two safety split. Just a three-step drop. Looks to the outside, then comes back inside. Nobody's around him. Easy touchdown for Montini. That was probably called from upstairs. They saw the same thing that I did, I'm sure.
14th touchdown pass of the year for Bobby Dobry. Pat Lyons on for the extra point. And a flag.
Wow, look at that, how quick. That is amazing. This must be a planned thing that Montini does. Really interesting here. Let's wait for the call here.
Dead ball foul. Encroachment. Defense. Half the distance to the goal. Replay the point.
Montini lined up to kick the extra point, and they shifted from standing up down to their knees, and as soon as Coal City jumped off sides, the whole offense ran out the field like they knew it was going to happen. It was amazing.
And now Montini will go for two. Murphy's the man in motion. The give is to Mucha. He's in for the two-point conversion. Mike Mucha makes it 8-0 Montini. We'll be back after these messages on the IHSA TV network. Pat Lyons kicks extra points and field goals. But this young man takes care of the kickoffs. That's Jeff Farnell. Sends it down inside the five.
Big hole, look out. Fumble on the play,
and
looks like.
Fumble on the return. That was Luke Turner. Brought it out to the 35, and it's Montini ball.
Wow. Second, third effort there, costing the fumble because he was about to go down, I think, at extra effort. Someone reached in, pulled out the fumble. We'll see it here on the replay. Nice return. Nice hole up the middle. Good blocking. Good execution. He kind of gets stopped right here.
He's
extra effort. Yeah, look at.
He's trying to say to the officials he was down.
Yeah, it looks
hard
like.
It's hard to see in that pile. No instant replay in high school anyway. It doesn't matter. He is called for the turnover, and the give is to Mike Mucha, and he's down inside the 30-yard line. So a big break for the Broncos if they can take advantage here. Up 8-0, and they get the ball back on the turnover.
Tough for Coal City. The name of their game is field position and making people go long distances against this defense. They don't believe people are going to be able to go 85, you know, 90 yards on this team, but they can go 35 yards.
And they've got the big edge, as you see, on the line when they've got the ball. Second down and four for Montini. Fakes the give. A little straight arm for Bobby Dobry, and he's brought down out of bounds at the 20-yard line. It's Kyle Lardy, the middle linebacker, with the tackle. You know, they always say, Greg, they came to play. It's the worst cliche in sports. I don't like it, but it's true when you talk about Montini. Now, for the 11th time in 14 games, they've scored on their opening possession. I mean, that's not fooling around. And it's, of course, you always like to play with a lead, but that tells you something about this team. They come out and they get after it right from the opening bell.
It says a lot about their coach as well.
Here's Mucha inside the five. And down at about the 3-yard line, but there's a flag on the play, and it's going to come back.
That big front line right now, Montini is controlling that line of scrimmage, but somebody was controlling it a little illegally, so they're going to be bringing it back.
Motion penalty on the offense, 5 yards, repeat, second down.
This happens a little bit with Montini's backs.
First down.
Both Mucha and Borsellino, they tend to lean forward right before the snap, and they oftentimes get called on that.
So instead of first and goal from the 4, it's first and 15 now from the 25. Gives to Borsellino, and he's brought down at the line of scrimmage by Nick Hart, the big defensive end. He had a couple of sacks in Saturday's win last week over Quincy Notre Dame in the semifinals. He is a big, strong young man, 6'3", 235, and has great pursuit from that outside. He really played a whale of a game in the semifinals.
This is a critical drive here for Coal City's defense. They are not a real offensively explosive team, as we mentioned. They do not want to get down 2 scores early like this.
Just under 6 minutes to go now, first quarter. Dobry back to throw. Doesn't have a man. Now he runs on his own. Throws it into the end zone. It's picked off. Howard picks it off for Coal City. Brandon Howard tied an IHSA state playoff record with 5 interceptions. That's right, 5 against Prairie Central, and he comes up with a big one here in the end zone to deny Montini after the turnover.
Dobry made 2 mistakes. You had a guy in the slant. He had Ravain in the slant, didn't choose to go to him. Then he had nobody in front of him, could have ran, decides to throw it down, kind of up for grabs. Great interception, big, big play for Coal City.
Brandon Howard with his 7th interception of the year, and 5 of them came in that Prairie Central contest. So the Kohlers get it back. Now Nick Smith is in there, number 13. It's the give to Watson. Instead, the big guy gets outside, stays in bounds, and gets a first down. How about that run by big Matt Watson? 15-yard gain, 6'3", 240, and he was pretty nimble over on the sidelines.
He can motor. He's a good athlete, as we mentioned before. The inside hole was covered. He bounced it outside. I was worried for that little defensive back. I don't know who it was, but I'm afraid he was going to get run over. But nice tackle and nice gain for Coal City.
We got to go. We watched from the sidelines last week in the second half, and Matt Watson is not small. Here's the give to Smith. Broken thumb, and he's out there and gains a couple of yards. He has really struggled with the injuries. Zach Smith, in the playoffs, injured his ankle in week 10, which is the first round of the playoffs against Dunlap, missed the next game against Mendota, broke his thumb the following week against Prairie Central, and did not play against Quincy Notre Dame. As we look at the lines, and both offensive lines have a little edge when it comes to the poundage per man. Nick Smith is the lone back. Watson in motion. Hodgen back to throw. Can't avoid the rush.
Mike
Mucha almost got him, pressured him, and it was big Joe Vasquez who stepped up and eventually stopped him.
Montini's starting to bring more pressure. 2 plays ago, they brought Blackwell off the corner. Here they bring Mucha off the corner from his outside linebacker spot. He gets a hand on him, knocks him down. Good pressure from Montini. They're doing it with bringing linebackers, putting the pressure on Hodgen. And we got 3rd and 13, a big play for Jeff here. They put him out back in the shotgun here.
Nick Smith is back there with him. Hodgen steps up, flushed out of the pocket, tries to reach for an extra yard or so. That's a little bit dangerous when you're 13 yards away from the first down.
You think he thought the yard marker was the one closest to him, but not 10 yards down the field.
So the Montini defense steps up there. And it's fourth and 13.
Montini does a good job rushing the passer. We mentioned before, Highland with 29 sacks. They've got a couple other. We have 13 sacks by Blackwell. Davis has 12, so they can get to the passer.
Borsellino and Murphy back to receive the punt. Not a very good one into that wind. And the Kohlers will down it at the 44-yard line where Montini will take over. 22-yard punt. Tough sledding going left to right on your TV screen today for the punters. The Montini touchdown in the first quarter significant. The Kohlers had only given up one first quarter touchdown all year, and that was to Prairie Central in the quarterfinals. Yeah, very good defense this year.
They don't give many touchdowns up in any quarter.
No, they don't. First and 10 for the Broncos. Dobry back to throw. Looks downfield. And it's picked off again, and it's that man again. Brandon Howard. He has a nose for the football in the postseason. One INT in the regular season. And now he's got seven in the postseason. Five against Prairie Central and two here today.
Dobry drops back. He looked at his receiver the whole way. And comes over, makes another great catch. Nice job catching the ball at its highest point. Brandon Howard does a good job going up and not letting the receiver catch the ball.
He's a 5'9", 160-pound senior, but he got some good hang time there. Man in motion now, the pitch to Watson. The big fella brought down from behind. And that's, check that. That's Brad Blackwell with the tackle.
That's one of their favorite plays. They run it on a lot of different formations. They'll switch, and you won't know exactly what formation they're in, but they like to get that sweep. They like to get their running backs to the outside. We saw it earlier when Rodgers got out there. Or Watson, that is. I don't know where it came
from. There's a look at the turnovers. Boy, an unusual amount so far in this ball game for these two teams who have taken good care of the ball up to this point. Watson and Smith are split in the backfield. Hodgen back to throw. Gets it off just before the pressure. Arndt with the catch. You only have to get 1 foot down. He did. And it's a completion out to the 47-yard line. 20 yards on the pitch and catch from Hodgen to Big Nick Arndt, who really can go up and get the football, Greg.
This is a beautiful throw. It's tough. Earlier they had double coverage, and he had to throw it out of bounds. Here he throws in. He can get it in just over the outstretched arm of the defense. Woo! 1 foot inbounds. Great catch by Arndt. Great throw by Hodgen. Those are the kind of plays that Coal City is going to have to make to score in this football game.
He had a 15-yard touchdown reception in the semifinals. They give to Nick Smith, and he's met at the line by Joe Davis, number 50, and Jimmy Riema, number 60, for Montini. No gain on the play. We're under 2 minutes to go here, first quarter. Montini High School out of Lombard with the 8-0 lead over the Coal City Kohlers. Hodgen back to throw. Weak side pursuit. Can't get it off in time. Oh, my goodness, what a hit by Marty Highland, the defensive end. He's not a big defensive end, but boy, can he move.
Well, 28 times he sacked the quarterback before he threw it. This time, Hodgen just gets off just before he gets hit. Nice pressure from Highland from the backside. Highland's a junior. Davis, two of their best defensive players are juniors. Great effort there by Highland. Forcing third and long. He'll get another chance probably right here to rush the passer.
Hodgen in the shotgun. Twin receivers right and left on third down. Hodgen looking for Arndt again, but nothing there. He throws it out of bounds, bringing up fourth down.
Hodgen had his receiver open over there. He just threw it a little bit high, maybe into the wind. Maybe the wind took that a little over his head, but he had his receiver open, just didn't hit him.
Ben Rouse now to punt, 37-yard average for the Coal City Junior. He will be punting into the wind. Murphy and Borsellino back. Murphy will get it at the 24. Back pedals a little bit, avoids a couple of tacklers. Good block there. And he gets out to the 35-yard line before he's tackled. Ben Murphy with the return. There was a really good block. I couldn't pick up the number, but a nice block on that 11-yard return, 27-yard punt.
Net 16 yards again. Both punts that they've had really haven't almost been worth it. They might as well go for it if they're only going to get 10 to 15, 16 yards on that field position.
Mooch is not in the backfield this time. Instead, brought down at the line is Peter Kenny, reserve running back. Mucha gets a blow and then comes back in. The Sun-Times Little School Player of the Year, big number 33, is 5'11", 217-pound senior, and he runs behind that big fella right there, Brandon Fry, 6'5", 320.
And he moves. Fry doesn't just block. He can move. He pulls. He traps. He's a good football player.
Here's Borsellino on the inside handoff, and he's up near the 40-yard line. Gain of about five. Time winding down here in the first quarter. Just 20 seconds left. It's third and five for the Broncos. And they'll get one more play off.
They'll get the win for one more play.
Borsellino and Mooch in the backfield. Borsellino gets it, and he's hammered at the line by big Matt Watson.
Great play by Watson. That's one of their favorite plays, Montini, is that little step back trap to Borsellino. Great job reading it. Watson stepped in the hole and made the play.
Charge to Montini.
And Montini takes timeout so they can punt with the win.
Smart, Coach Andriano. It's good call. Field position being important, they'll get an extra 15 to 20 yards on this punt, punting with the win.
. 26 years for Chris Andriano at Montini High School, Hall of Famer, 178 career wins. He's been at the school 31 years. It's only been in existence 38 years. So he has pretty much been Broncos football to that area, to that school, that community. He's made it to the semifinals three times. 17th playoff appearance for the Broncos, 12th in a row. Never made it to the big game until today.
Yeah, they've had a lot of great teams, just haven't had the ball bounce their way. And this year, they've really put everything together to get this team down here to Champaign.
Neil Ravain will punt. He is a Sun-Times All-Stater. 38.7-yard average for him. And the lone man back for Coal City is Brandon Howard, who's picked off a couple of passes in this ball game. Kick it away from him. He's a pretty good return man, and it takes a Montini bounce. Oh, my goodness. Inside the 10, it's still rolling. It's down at the 6-yard line. 54-yard punt. Thank you very much, Neil Ravain. We will be back. 8-0 our score, back after these local messages.
That play ends the first quarter.
And welcome back to Memorial Stadium here in Champaign-Urbana. Lee Hall, Greg Bradshaw, 4A state championship football. It's really been a great day here weather-wise for high school football, Greg.
It has
nothing,
been.
Nothing like last
yeah,
year.
Really, temperature-wise, it's not real bad tonight. We just had the wind to deal with. At least we have no rain and no snow.
A couple of state champions already crowned. Sterling Newman over Carthage 21-7 in the 2A championship game, which was actually played first. Cole City and Montini going for a state championship here in 4A. Here's the give to Watson inside. Going to be tough for one man to bring him down.
Nice inside play to Watson, little fake outside, give back to Watson coming back in, breaks a tackle, falls forward for 7 yards, nice gain on first down, especially when you're backed up against your own end zone.
Jimmy Falakos actually caught up with him and brought him down. There you get a look at the play calling, 34 rushes, 151 yards on the ground per game.
Yep.
They throw it a little bit too and get a pretty good good payback on that.
That's a good indication. They have about 270 yards of total offense a game, which is not phenomenal. It shows you how much they rely on their defense.
Hodgen back to throw from his own five. Has a man, Nick Arndt. Flag on the play as Arndt steps out of bounds.
An illegal chop block.
Yep.
Somebody came from the outside in, probably maybe see it on the replay, but that's going to cost him half the distance to the goal. Negates that first down run, which they had was good positive yards with their back to the end zone.
The waist on the offense. Half the distance to the goal. Repeat second down.
And we get that all straightened out, and it'll bring up second and 10 from the six. So, Cole City have moved from within the shadow of their own goal line, but now they're back there again. Hodgen standing with 1 foot in the end zone as he takes the snap and the shotgun from his own end zone. Throws to Nick Arndt, has it, complete. Down at the 47-yard line, Pat Lyons there for the coverage. 41 yards on the completion. Hodgen to Nick Arndt. Nick had 30 receptions coming into this ball game on the season.
It's a great play. It shows the strength, arm strength of Hodgen. He rolls right, throws all the way back across the field, and Nick Arndt goes in between two defenders and makes the play.
Big play for the Kohlers.
Huge play right there.
Get out near midfield. Boy, anytime you a play like that, especially from your own goal line, is huge. Backs in the eye, it's Watson and Smith. The give is to Smith, who gets just a couple. Zach Smith gained 899 yards.
Joey Borsellino.
13 touchdowns coming into this ball game. As we mentioned, though, he's been hampered by the injuries. He's practiced all week, and the coach is pretty confident in him.
Montini again. That time they brought Mucha off the corner from his defensive back spot, came in and made the tackle. Looks like when they get to Cole City, get some positive yards, they want to stem that momentum by bringing some pressure with the defensive backfield.
Watson in motion. Hodgen back to throw. Here comes the pressure. He runs out of it. Shakes a tackler at the 50. There's a flag as he dives out of bounds at the 44-yard line. Like, I thought Hodgen was kind of all alone there. Maybe a face mask? Let's see.
Inadvertent face mask. On the defense, 5-yard penalty. Penalty will be assessed from the end of the run.
Nice call, Lee. Nice call, Lee.
That's one in a row.
I did not see that. I am impressed. I was just about to say Cole City, every time they make a positive play, they'd have a negative one, but that went their way. First time they've had the ball across the 50 today.
You see the athleticism of Jeff Hodgen, who's thrown for 1,500 yards, but he did a nice job there, weaving through traffic, shaking a tackler. Backs in the eye, Watson and Howard. Hodgen back to throw, looks downfield, pops off of his man, and incomplete. The Kohlers want pass interference. Drew Vickers was the intended receiver.
Pretty physical defense right here by Pat Lyons. Hodgson goes back after the fake. He sees his man open. He throws it across the field. You see a little bit of contact. See a little bit of holding there.
Ooh.
Could have easily been called.
Was it a catchable ball?
Yeah, that was totally catchable. The fans just saw it here on the new Illini scoreboard, and there's a lot of boos coming from the sideline of Cold City.
They really do it upright there. I'll tell you, they launch balloons. They have fireworks. Fans
music,
out on the field.
Great music.
Oh, yeah.
Or Cold City.
And you can hear it in Wilmington. That's the great thing. They really crank it up. Howard with the carry. And nowhere to go. Good job that time by the Montini defense. Marty Highland in on the stop.
You can see that Cole City's reverting a little bit to the air. We thought that was going to have to happen. We talked about Hodgson going to have to throw the football today for them to move it. They're not really moving the ball too much on the ground. So they're looking for him to throw the ball through the air.
Third and 13 now for the Kohlers. Hodgson's in the shotgun. Watson's back there for company and to help keep Montini out of his face. Incomplete. Rouse was the intended receiver, but they couldn't connect, and that'll bring up fourth down for the Kohlers.
Little bit of hesitation on the sidelines by Coach Onsen, but he's going to punt the ball here, which I think is the good move. Put them back in the hole against the wind and make them go the length of the field and rely on their good defense to give them good field position before halftime.
Joey Borsellino standing at his own 10-yard line. Rouse back to punt. And he got too much of it. Tried to aim for the corner, but got too much of the kick and not enough of the corner. Kicked it 42 yards, but it'll come back out to the 20, so that's a net of 22, and that's not that good either. You talked about that earlier.
It's not what you want when you got the win. You know, it's tough. You're punting against the win the first three times, and you're really having to kick everything you got. Then you come back, and you got the win, and you got to almost ease up a little bit because the win just took that well into the end zone. We talked about it for keys of the game. One of the things that Cole City needs to do is to force turnovers. This would be a great time for one right here to get the ball before halftime here and get an opportunity.
8:57 to go, second quarter. 8-0, the Montini lead. Borsellino and Mucha in the backfield. Here's Mucha. It's about 5 yards before he's brought down. 226 carries on the season coming into today, and Coach Andriano says when he's out on that field, he is just mean-spirited. He is all football player, and he runs like it. I mean, he runs hard and tough. Second and 6 for the Broncos. Mucha again. Martis had him from behind, and Mucha takes him for about a 3-yard ride there to bring up third down.
And we haven't really seen the Montini running game as effective as we've been told. I mean, we've seen some film. You've seen it. You watched them play. They're very, very effective usually running the football. They have not had the big play that they're used to getting. Good job by Coal City's defense.
Third and a couple. Two receivers split right. Dobry keeps it, bounces off a tackler, and has the first down. Down at the 33-yard line, Bobby Dobry, a nice run by the senior quarterback who rushed for 568 yards and 8 touchdowns this season.
He's elusive. We've seen him already today break a couple of tackles and get some extra yards. That was a key one there on third down.
Broncos at the 33. Dobry back to throw, has a man, and the completion to number 22, Neil Ravine. 21-yard gain on the play.
We mentioned before the middle of the field continues to be open, They're looking right down the middle. You see Dobridge. He looks at them all the way, but there's a big hole right in the middle of the field. Nice job going down low to corral it. Big yardage for Montini.
Neil Ravain, 19 catches coming into the ball game. That's another Montini first down at the 45-yard line. They give to Mucha into the line, flag on the play. And it'll go against Montini. Here's a look at the play calling for the Broncos. It's about 80% running the ball and
they
20 throwing it.
Sure,
huh?
They definitely do want to always establish the run. They make their passes count, though. Dobry really has a great receiver
in
Ben Murphy.
On the offense, 5-yard penalty, repeat, first down.
Only 11 passes per game, but Dobry has 13 touchdowns on the year through the air. So when they do throw it, they're very effective and efficient with what they throw.
And the percentage is what Chris Andriano's impressed by and wants to brag about. 87 for 132, that's 66% completion rate for Dobry. Hand off to Borsellino. He's got some room around the left end and brought down out of bounds at about the 32-yard line after a gain of 13. Check that, 18. Joey Borsellino with the big run for the Broncos.
Nice job up front on the trap. You'll see it right here. The big guy pulls, nice kick out right there. He gets to the outside and he's got good speed, turns the corner. That's the kind of plays that Montini's used to seeing from Borsellino. He's got some quickness and explosiveness once he gets through the hole.
Chris Andriano says he's the perfect complement to Mike Mucha. That ball lofted to the right side. Murphy was over there, but not really anywhere close to the ball. Bring up second and 10.
It's like a little miscommunication there. Dobry thought that Murphy was going to go deep to the corner, and Murphy broke it off for a short hook pattern.
Here's a look at the scoring for Montini. 30 points a game, and look at the playoffs. And they've gotten better defensively all year long. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Second and 10, 6:49 to go here, second quarter. Backs are split, two receivers right for Bobby Dobry. Hands it off to Borsellino and bounces off a man and stumbles to the ground at the 25-yard line.
Same play that they just gained 18 yards before. They step back and give it to Borsellino on the trap play. If he keeps his feet, Lee, he probably scores there.
Now, he wasn't tackled. He just kind of bounced off of somebody, it looked like. That'll bring up third down and 4 for Montini. Receivers right and left this time for the Broncos. Hand off to Mucha inside. Keeps his feet, and he's down near the 10-yard line. He's got a first down.
Big Brandon Fry pulls from his left guard position. You'll see it right here. He comes out. See him, big 320 pounds coming at you. Runs and watch him finish it off. Here's Mucha. He keeps fighting. Watch, here comes big Brandon Fry. Watch this. Boom. Don't stand around the pile. With Brandon Fry, he's going some headhunting for his team.
15-yard game. How about the gain? How about Fry pulling at 320 pounds? Not much room for Mike Mucha that time. Bonerick in on the stop for Coal City.
Normally, a lot of teams put their biggest men at the tackle position, but with this team, they like their guards to be big because they do a lot of pulling, and if they're quick like Fry, it's great because they can get across, trap block, and seal that hole. And you're seeing that trap play be very successful on this drive.
Second and 8. And Dobry keeps it himself that time. Brock Martis was there for the stop. That'll bring up third and 8.
Big play here for Coal City. If they can hold them to a field goal, it's really a small victory for them. Third and nine, so I think we might see a timeout here from Montini. It is a big play. They're going to think about it a little bit.
And it is a timeout for Montini, up 8-0. We will be back in Champaign after these local messages. And we are back at Memorial Stadium. Montini taking a chance to talk about it before third down and nine with an 8-0 lead on Cole City here in our 4A state championship game. Sterling, Newman, and Alexis United already crowned champions today in 2A and 1A respectively. Another suburban Catholic Conference team plays for a state championship next. Dobry to Murphy. Touchdown! 10-yard touchdown, Dobry to Ben Murphy, his 10th touchdown catch of the year. Good timeout.
Yeah, it was a well-designed play. They sent Murphy in motion all the way across the formation and got their defensive back a little bit off balance, cut back in on a quick slant play. Nice delivery by Dobry for a real simple little slant for 6 points.
Pat Lyons will come on for the extra point. That's up and good. And it's Montini with the 15-0 lead over Cole City. Back in just a moment on the IHSA TV network. Bobby Dobry, his second touchdown pass of the night, his 15th of the season.
Simple. They sent Murphy in motion. The ball snapped. He turns around. Quick slant. Three-step drop. Dobry delivers right between the numbers for 6 points and a 15-0 Montini lead.
Jeff Farnell to kick it. Howard and Luke Turner are back for Cole City. Howard with it at the 10. Has a lane out to the 25 and tackled from behind. Brought down at the 30-yard line. Casey Lieberg in on the tackle. 20-yard return for Mr. Howard, who might be the MVP so far for Cole City. He's got a couple of interceptions.
Yeah, Montini had good field position most of that first quarter. And those two interceptions really helped. Otherwise, we might see a bigger lead right now than 15-0.
Hodgen tries to move his team and get him on the board here. The fake to Watson. Hodgen on the keeper. Gets about three. It'll be second and seven. Marty Hyland's slow to get up for Montini.
We might see a little bit more shotgun, obviously, now that they're down 15-0. Their running game has not been real successful. And we might see some more consistent shotgun formation from the Kohlers.
Hyland took a knee, and now the official is waving him off.
Jeff Hodgen likes to see that. 28 sacks running off the field.
Yeah. Jim Falakos, number 51, comes in for Montini, and we're set on second and seven. Hodgen in the shotgun again. And a whistle will stop play.
Wide receiver moved just a little early. It's going to cost him 5 yards.
Ball start on the offense. 5 yard penalty. Repeat second down.
No rhythm from Cole City's offense today. They get started, they go back with the penalty. They make a big play, they have two negative yard plays, just haven't had real good rhythm on their offense.
Second and 12 for the Kohlers. Hodgen back to pass. Here comes the rush. Just avoids it, steps out of bounds at the 20. Boy, he should have thrown that one away. Easy to say from up here, I know.
Well, unlike professional football, once you're out of the pocket, you can throw it anywhere. You've got to make an attempt to get it towards somebody, and maybe he couldn't find anyone. But that's unfortunate. It takes another 5 yards back. They're going the wrong direction. They've lost 12 yards in their last two plays, bringing up third and 20.
Good pressure that time by the Montini defense. Third and a long way. Here comes Highland. Hodgen gets it away before he gets hit. Vickers was the intended receiver. The Kohlers won another flag.
Good coverage again by Montini secondary.
Brings up fourth down.
We talked about the Montini defense getting better, and it kind of reminds you of that old Beatles song, "We're Getting Better All the Time." First four games, they gave up almost 30 points a game. The last nine games, only 9.5 points a game. Chris Andriano put in a different offense, or different defense, rather, this year. They went to a 4-3 as opposed to a 5-2, which they played in the past. And it took a little while to get used to, but they have really taken to it. Ben Rouse back to kick again. Murphy and Borsellino stand at their own 45. And Borsellino has to go way back. Back. The famous man once said, it's inside the 10. Look at that. And it will be marked at the 7-yard line. 74-yard punt for Ben Rouse.
For Rouse.
Who averages 37.
Montini takes over at its own 7-yard line.
They didn't list a long punt for him in the stats, well, but I'm guessing that's got to be pretty close.
That's a huge play, too, for Cole City, because they, if they don't get a deep, good punt here, they're in danger of going down by 3 scores before half. Now they got a chance to hold them. They could use their timeouts if necessary and get a chance to put something on the board before half.
Lenny Olson would like to see another interception by Mr. Howard or some other kind of turnover here. 3:23 left in the first half. It's 15-0 Montini. Bobby Dobry under center. He's got 2 touchdown passes in this ball game. He's back to throw again. Has time. Good protection. And throws to an assistant coach on the Montini sideline. Lombard Montini. They decided they were going to build a high school in 1963. The same year that Pope Paul VI was elected Pope, and Montini was the Pope's family name. That's how they came up with the name Montini. Yeah, I knew you'd be
That's
interested.
That's an excellent that. Fact. Excellent fact.
Yeah. That's good Catholic high school boys. We have to know those things, Coach.
I want to hear about 3 or 4 more of those interesting facts before the game's over.
Second and 10. Give us to Mucha. Not a lot of room there.
Mike Mucha, the ball carrier.
Brian Naden got some good penetration there for the Kohlers.
Tackle by number 8, Brian Naden.
It's a good example how a big punt can change the complexion, because a few minutes ago you'd think all the momentum was going to be on Montini's side. They stopped them. They've got to punt the ball from their own, 20-25-yard line. We kick it down to the 7-yard line. Now it's third and long, and they got to be looking at getting the ball potentially back at the 45 if they can hold them. Watch the middle of the field again here.
Third and 9. Dobry throws from his own 2-yard line. Has Murphy out at the 22, and that is first down yardage. Marked at the 23. First down for the Broncos. Big play that time by Bobby Dobry. Boy. Found his man, Ben Murphy, out there.
Excellent execution all the way around. Very simple play. Murphy goes down about 12 to 14 yards just past the first down marker. Dobry throws it on time. Great protection. Very simple. You can tell they've been working on that probably throughout the summer, through all year. Great timing pass. First down for Montini.
Here's the give to Borsellino. He busted a run a little bit earlier. Loose ball. The Cole City crowd gets excited for a moment, but it's whistled down, as I think the ground may have forced that fumble by Borsellino, who hustles back to the huddle a little gingerly that time.
Tell you what, I'd get a little more excited on that, just because you never know. They had the ball in their hand, and they kind of just threw it back down like it wasn't a fumble. That's when you got to get everybody to say, it's our ball.
Right.
You never know.
You got to sell it.
Yeah. It's part of the game.
Minute 35 to go, first half. Second and 5 now for Montini. Here's Mucha, has a lane. and fights across the 35-yard line to about the 37.
Interesting decision here for Coach Andriano. Now he's up to the 36-yard line with a minute 20. Do they get aggressive and try to get one more score before half, or do they just run the ball here? I got a feeling they're coming out of the huddle pretty quick. I think they're going to take a shot here and try to score again before half.
They have one timeout left.
Yep, they're dropping back.
Dobry to throw. Here comes the pressure. Watson and Martis with the sack. Give it to Watson. Matt Watson, team leader with 14 sacks, good for 106 yards. And he comes up with a big one that time.
I've been impressed so far with Watson. He looks like he's a pretty good athlete. He's moving quick for his size. He's made some good plays on defense and on offense.
We have a charge timeout. Cole City.
Cole City will take their first timeout. Hoping to maybe get the ball back. There you get a look at Chris Andriano. The wide receiver at Palatine High School back in the day and played college ball at Millikan down in these parts. There's the playoff history. 4 appearances for Cole City, 5 for Montini, 17 straight for both schools. How's that for tradition? 18-15 record, 25-16 for Montini. Cole City won the state championship back in 1993. This is the first state championship appearance for Montini High School.
Interesting timeout there for Coach Olson. I think Montini was thinking another score. Now they get the sack, so now I'm not sure what they're going to do. Will they just try to run the football out here and go in the locker room up 2 scores?
Ominous moon over Memorial Stadium. And there are wild creatures about. They are excited, aren't they?
Everybody they know is here, though, so that they're waiting, like, come look at me, but they don't. Everybody from Cole City's here.
That's right. They get fired up for their football. 49 seconds to go here, first half. 2nd and 15. Dobry puts a man in motion and gives to Borsellino.
Joey Borsellino.
Gets just across the 35-yard line. And another timeout for Lenny Olson and Cole City.
Charge timeout, Cole City. That's our 2nd timeout. They have 1 remaining.
We'll be right back, 15-0. Back with more from Champaign after this network break. And we are back. 40 seconds to go here. First half, Montini with the ball in a 15-0 lead. 3rd and 12, Cole City has taken consecutive timeouts, hoping to get the ball back, hoping to force Cole City to punt into this wind and get the ball back for a shot at a score. Dobry back in the pocket, had protection, picked off by Naden at the 30-yard line, and that might have gone further than a punt would have.
Yeah, it's definitely, Montini is not upset with that right there. It's worth the attempt.
There's big Brandon Fry right there, 320 pounds. Chris Andriano says he is a mountain of a man. When you stand behind him, the sun disappears.
And he's only a junior, Lee. He's probably still growing. Next year, he could be 6'7", 340. He's a big man, and he moves. I'm so impressed with how he moves. They trap him, and they get him outside. He can run.
Coach Andriano says he needs to lose maybe about 20 pounds, but he's getting plenty of Division I attention already. Hodgen back to throw, sack from behind. Might have been Ryland who hit him from behind. They're going to say,
we're going to call it
incomplete pass.
Wow, what a break for Cole City.
Yeah, they say his arm was in motion. I said sack, but he was hit from behind.
I think it's a good thing that for Cole City we don't have instant replay. Here it is. You see, he holds the ball. He's looking downfield. There's nobody open. Good job by the defensive backfield. Here it comes. Ooh, that's close. That's close.
I'm glad I don't have to make that kind of call. That was close. Maybe a break there for Cole City. 26 seconds left. Hodgen has a man. Great catch. That's that guy again, Howard. And he's brought down at the 42. They need to call timeout quickly. 28-yard gain.
The clock stops on the first down, but they got to get up, and they got to either down it or throw the play real quick downfield. Looks like they're going to down it. Good job by Coal City getting up to the line of scrimmage quickly. He's going to down it.
Hodgen spikes it.
Nice job. Nice job. Good discipline by that offensive line. That getting down there quickly, getting ready to go.
2 seconds to spike it.
Yep.
So the Kohlers will have 16 seconds to go. And how about Mr. Howard? Brandon Howard, a couple of picks and a 28-yard reception there, and a couple of good punt returns. It was a kickoff return.
Right.
Sorry.
Good first half. Ben Rouse, their place kicker, Lee, has kicked a 48-yard field goal this year, so they may be thinking, let's get him field goal range at minimum and give him a shot with the win. He could probably kick one from 50 today if he's already made one from 48.
Trips right for Coal City. Here comes the pressure. He gets it away in time. Arndt at the 30. He's spending a lot of time. 5 seconds to go.
They did get the first down. They're probably going to have to use their timeout here. Yep, they're going to have to use their timeout.
Rouse is out on the field, and looks like he was practicing that swing.
From here, it's a 47-yard field goal, and he has one from 48. And he's got the win, and they're bringing him out. It's going to be fun.
It's a little bit more uniform surface than he's probably used to kicking off of.
Did a nice job getting that ball in the middle of the field, perfectly right down the middle.
Yes, he did.
I don't know if he thought about that, but let's give him the benefit of the doubt.
I was more worried about him using up
too much
time. Yeah,
It's like the Montana defense. Don't tackle him. Don't tackle him. We got 5 more seconds. Let him run around. This would give him a lift if they'd go in with this 3 points.
The Kohlers trying to get on the scoreboard here. Their offense did not score earlier this year in the first half against Wilmington, and they led that game 4-0 on a couple of safeties at the half.
Montini doesn't look like they're going to rush it. They're maybe staying back, assuming there might be a fake, but
Ben Rouse is 4 of 12, but he does have that one long one. This one's up, left.
Pull the left.
Yep. Yeah, he had, I think the distance was there. It wouldn't have made it by a lot, but he pulled it left. It's no good, and the Broncos go to the locker room with a 15-0 lead. We talk a lot about the Kohlers' defense, but the Montini defense really did a number on the Kohlers here in the first half. Let's go down to Mike Kleff.
All right, Lee and Greg, thank you very much. We are with Chris Andriano, the Montini head coach. And, Chris, if I told you before the game you'd be up 15-0 at the half, you'd take it.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Our defense has really stepped up. They're playing great football. We had a couple of opportunities that we didn't take advantage of in the first half. So we're going to try to, remedy a couple of things at halftime. It's going to be a good second half.
Chris, you've done a lot of good things in the first half. What do you want to fine-tune?
Well, you know, our first down play. I mean, we got to make something first down happen, and they're putting us in some bad spots. We got to try to get the first down situation, and then we can mix things up better.
All right, Chris, thanks a lot. Good luck.
Thanks so much.
All right, Chris Andriano, the Montini Broncos leading 15-0 at the half. They're 24 minutes away from a state championship. Lee and Greg.
All right, Mike, thank you very much. 15-0. Our halftime score, Montini leading Coal City. Back after these local messages.
All right, welcome back to Memorial Stadium. We are at halftime of the 4A state championship game between Coal City and Montini. The Broncos leading 15-0. Right now, time to meet the cheerleaders from Coal City and the Kohlers. And first of all, let's get your name.
Alex Elledge.
All right, how about your name?
Meredith McClucky.
How about you?
Alyssa Youngquist.
All right, your name?
Amy Pryor.
All right, all of them. All right, how much fun are you having?
It's awesome. It's great.
You like doing a cheer?
Yeah.
All right, take it away. The cheerleaders from Coal City, the Kohlers right now in the 4A state championship game. They're trailing the Broncos right now 15-0. Very, very impressive. Hey, by the way, tell me about the dude, the guy who wears the helmet that stands with you guys.
Oh, that's our Charlie Kohler. He is our mascot. His name is Kyle Hockey. We are so happy to have him. He's so good.
Do you have tryouts for that, or does he just want to do it?
He was just one that wanted to do it, so we let him do it.
All right. Hey, I'll tell you what, thanks a lot. And before we talk to the administration from Coal City, we have to take a short break and hear from these local sponsors. Actually, this break is going to be from the network, and we'll be right back. All right, welcome back to Memorial Stadium. We're at halftime of the 4A game. Montini leading Coal City 15-0. And now we are with the acting and associate principal of Coal City, Susan Rutkowski. And Susan, thanks for joining us. And, you know, even though your team's trailing right now, I know you're awfully proud of this team.
This team has been just incredible. The spirit and just how much energy that they've exhibited through the whole season has been incredible.
We're going to talk to him in a few minutes, but tell me about your head coach, Lenny Onson.
Lenny is a great coach. He's been there for a long time, and I know he's been very, very excited. Lenny's a teacher besides a coach, and I think that that's his approach when he works with our football players. Teacher first, coach second, and he tells everybody that they can do a good job and they can go out and do this.
What's the best part about being part of the Coal City School District?
Absolutely, the community and the support that the community gives us, and also just the spirit of the students and the great staff.
Susan, it's a situation right here. I know you're not playing in the game, you're not coaching in the game, but you feel like you are in the game. I mean, the nerves are rolling, aren't they?
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's a real nail biter, and we just hope for the best. And I know I have confidence in our students.
Hey, it's not done yet.
I know.
Two scores, you're right there.
Absolutely, absolutely.
All right, Susan Rutkowski, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
All right, Susan Rutkowski, the acting and associate principal of Coal City High School. We will hear from Montini's cheerleaders and administration right after we hear from these local sponsors. All right, welcome back to Memorial Stadium, the 4A state championship game. Montini, the Broncos, well, they're doing very well in their first ever state championship football game. They are leading Coal City 15-0. These are some very happy cheerleaders right now. Hey, you've got momentum going. Go ahead and do a cheer. You got momentum going. All right. Hey, that's right. Let's go Broncos. So first of all, who gets credit for making the headband stocking caps?
Our coach.
Which coach?
Coach Tiffany.
Really?
Yeah.
Are they warm?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. What's the best thing about being a Montini cheerleader?
Being at the games and cheering everyone on.
Rock.
Yeah.
Cheering our team on to
victory. Yeah.
What do you think of the first half?
Awesome. It's so cool. Amazing.
Rock is the best.
Yeah.
We got it.
All right. Hey, thanks a lot. Good luck the second half. And we will hear from Montini's administration. Actually, right now, we're going to look for them right now. They're right back here. So, all right. Here is the Montini administration, and thanks for joining us. And first of all, if I say the president's name right here, I forgive you. I hope I say this right. Is it Jim Segreto or Segreto?
Segreto.
Segreto. Jim Segreto. First of all, congratulations on a great season.
Thank you.
And Jim is the president of Montini High School. And first of all, Jim, on a day-to-day basis, what is your main responsibility at the school?
Well, my main responsibility is to oversee the entire operation of the school, from the physical plan to the development efforts of the school, the public relations for the school, the business side of the school, where our principal, Mrs. O'Neill, handles the day-to-day operation of the school, the academics, the extracurricular programs, and handles all that for us.
Jim, in all seriousness, this is a very, very unique state championship game for you guys. Number one, you're here. It's the first time ever. Congratulations. But also, Driscoll Catholic, which plays in the next game, the 3A game. Well, obviously, you're used to butting heads against them, and now you're in a situation where, hey, you're their biggest fans after your game's over, aren't you?
That is correct. We have a great relationship with Driscoll Catholic. They're our sister school. We're both LaSallian Catholic high schools. We have a great rivalry, a healthy rivalry between both schools. We see each other in conference, and we see each other usually in the state playoffs. This year they dropped down to 3A, but we're excited for them. They're excited for us, and our administrations have been talking, and there's a lot of support for both schools from both administrations and student bodies. So we're very proud of both schools.
Let's talk about Chris Andriano. I used to work with Chris's sister. I mean, this is a guy who's put in the time. He can flat out coach, and here he is. He's 24 minutes away from the biggest moment of his life. How good is this guy?
Well, he's just a tremendous role model for the young men and the young women of our school. He does it the right way. He teaches the young men to play the game the right way. He is probably one of the finest sportsmen I've ever met in my life. All the coaches in the state of Illinois, especially in our conference, respect Chris. He deserves to be here. Obviously, we're very happy for the young men, and you know, they're the ones that got us here. But we're also very, very happy for Chris, and he deserves to be down there, and hopefully he can bring us home a championship.
Jim, thanks a lot. Good luck.
Thank you very much.
All right, and now we have the principal of Montini High School. And first of all, welcome very much here. And this is Marianne O'Neill, the principal of Montini. And Marianne, how are you feeling at halftime right now? Obviously, there's a reason you're smiling.
I'm feeling really great right now. The kids have done a great job. They've had a great season. They're a group that has worked together. They play as a team. Unity has been their theme and their motto all year, and I think we're seeing that on the field today.
Marianne, in all seriousness, just like I asked Jim, your relationship with Driscoll Catholic, I mean, in the past, I mean, he called it a healthy rivalry. It still is, but this time, I mean, there's a new twist. I mean, you get to root for them at the state finals, and you're still playing as well. It's really, it must feel different.
It's a wonderful experience. Fred Muehlman, the principal at Driscoll, and I graduated from the Sam LaSallian Leadership Institute. We've been good friends for years. I've been at Montini 19, and it's been healthy for us all the way along.
What's this experience been like so far? First time ever to the state football finals.
Wow. For me, it's been incredible. The kids have been remarkable, and I'm proud of them, not just because of their accomplishment getting down here today, but because they were also voted the Sportsmanship Award by the Suburban Catholic Conference. So they've been good on the field as well as off the field, being good leaders for the other kids in the school. And my kids went to Montini. My son played football. This is just incredible for me personally.
You've got great cheerleaders.
We've got awesome cheerleaders, we've got awesome pom team, we've got an awesome athletic team. But you know what? Cole City's good too. That second half is going to be tough. There's nothing taken for granted here.
Marianne O'Neill, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
She's the principal of Montini High School. We're at halftime. Montini leading Cole City 15-0 in the 4A state championship game. We will be right back after we hear from these local sponsors.
And we're back at halftime. Class 4A state championship football. Lombard Montini with the 15-0 lead over Cole City. The Colers unable to get much going offensively. And give credit to the Montini defense. Only five first downs for Cole City and
23 yards rushing only for Cole
rushing,
City.
Yeah.
And they want to establish the run because they're really not a passing team.
Right, pretty good balance there for Montini. 81 yards on the ground, 62 in the air. Three Montini turnovers. They were able to overcome that as you take a look at some of the other numbers. 5-for-12 passing for Hodgen. 5-for-11 for Bobby Dobry. Let's take a look at those first half highlights.
Here's Bobby Dobry.
Yep, the first pass wide open down the middle. Great job just analyzing it. Here's the big kickoff return and does a great job returning it. Fumbles the ball here just at the very end of the play. Kind of questionable. We weren't sure, couldn't see much. Turned into 6 points for Montini. Here they come down the field. A little scramble here by Dobry. Another works. Look at the interception here. This is a nice play in the end zone. Montini really could have been up a lot more, with at least one and maybe two more scores if it weren't for these two interceptions. Right here, Howard goes up again, nice and high, makes the interception. And here's the touchdown, three-step drop. Dobry just delivers the ball right between the numbers to Murphy, falls in the end zone, 15-0 Montini.
Dobry with two touchdown passes, and there's another
interception
for the Kohlers.
So really, their defense is not playing horrible. They've been put in some difficult situations because Coal City isn't really moving the football. Go back to the keys of the game. Coal City has to stop the big plays. They've done a fairly decent job of that. Montini team has driven the ball short on short field, so it hasn't been too bad. Turnovers equals triumph. They've got three turnovers, but really hasn't turned those into positive points. And lastly, Hodgen, we look for a big half from Hodgen. He's going to have to make some great plays for them to win the football game. Montini up front, the big guys are doing a great job on those trap plays. Fry getting out in front and knocking people down. They're doing a good job. Murphy is touching the football. We just saw him score a touchdown, important. And the sweep play has not been successful for Coal City. So pretty much those keys they have been executing on. So that's why we've got a 15-0 Montini lead at the break.
Second half action coming up next after these local messages.
Football, little extra yardage, giving up third and five.
Matt Watson doing a nice job after catching the ball, yards after the catch.
Brings the blitz.
And Hodgen throws it to the wrong team. Picked off by Steve Erlenbaugh. 5'4" senior comes up with the pick. I told you not to say pick around a quarterback. It was an omen.
I apologize,
Mr. Hodgen. And good news for Montini.
He has his man open. Vickers is out there. He just kind of throws it behind him. You know, it wasn't like it was fantastic defense. He's in the right place at the right time. But Vickers was open. If Hodgen throws it towards the sidelines, it's a first down. Watch for the quick strike here. And a turnover.
7:22 to go, third quarter. Dobry rolls left. Martis is there to bring him down. So Brock Martis is okay. He's back in the game and brings down Dobry for no gain. Maybe a loss of a couple.
Nice play. And a little emotion, too. I like to see that. They need emotion. They're going to have to come up with big plays in the second half to get back in the football game. And emotion sometimes is what you need to create the extra excitement for a turnover, making the big play.
Second and 12, Mucha and Borsellino split in the backfield. Give is to Mucha, he's got some room. And now has room to the outside, to the 40, down to the 30, inside to the 20, 10, touchdown Mike Mucha! 62 yards on the run, and touchdown score for Montini. Mike Mucha with touchdown number 21 on the season.
Here's the play here. You'll see big number Brandon Fry, 77, coming across, kicking out. Now here's Mucha, 217 pounds actually, turning on the burners. And they had angles on him, Lee, and then he just ate it up all the way in, 6 points. That's that speed, that big playability we talked about at the beginning of the game.
Pat Lyons, the point after is good, and it's 22-0 Montini. 6:33 to go, third quarter, back after this network break on the IHSA TV network. Mike Mucha's 62-yard touchdown run gives Montini the 22-0 lead. Turner grabs the kickoff. He's out to the 30 and brought down at the 34-yard line. Let's go down to Mike Kleff. Michael?
Hey, Lee and Greg, just imagine what's going through the emotions as far as Chris Andriano, the Montini head coach. Not only is he about 18 minutes away from his first ever state championship, but his son, Matt Andriano, is here. He's up in the press box. He also happens to be a Montini assistant coach. What a night. Back to you guys.
All right, Mike, thanks a lot. Well, Greg, you've coached with your father in the past. You know what
personal
that feeling is like.
Yeah, it is. Football in Illinois is really a family affair. We talked about the Reeds earlier today. We talked about the Borsellinos. It's an exciting thing when your whole family, your whole community gets involved. High school football in Illinois is a great thing. And I was fortunate to play in a state championship with my father as a coach, and we won the state championship. And there's not many better feelings that you can have with all the time, energy, and effort you put in. When you do it with your family, it's a lot of fun. Here's that formation again. We spread them out. Remember, the center is eligible.
Cole City back at the 19-yard line after a personal foul was called. Pass to Art is complete. He gets his foot in. He made a great catch in the first half as well. I believe it was the first quarter. He's out at the 29-yard line.
Well, that time they covered the center eligible, and then they left Mr. Arndt open. But that's a good adjustment. Here's a good look at it again. You see, this time they cover him, and they got him wide open, and Arndt right there on the right sideline. Good delivery of pass by Hodgen. That puts a lot of pressure on Hodgen. There's nobody blocking for him.
Second and one for the Kohlers. Backs are split. Fakes to Howard. Hodgen looking, doesn't have anybody open. He's got some time. Now here comes the defensive end chasing him down. Highland, Marty Highland almost got him. Hodgen wisely flipped it ahead out of bounds in the vicinity of a receiver and avoided the loss. It'll bring up third and one.
You said the right word, wisely, because if he goes out of bounds there, now it's third and seven. Instead, now they come back, it's third and about a foot.
Well, remember earlier in the game he did that.
That's
and
right.
We thought, well, he could have, should have, would have thrown
right.
It out and didn't. Cost himself some yardage. Cole City 1 of 7 on third down here tonight. Six of seven to go here, third quarter. Cole City trying to rally. And they give to Lardy, no gain.
That's the same play they ran on short yardage last time. And Montini was ready for it this time. Boy, it's going to be close. Oh, they gave him a first down. Wow. A little extra effort there by Lardy. Got it because it did not look like he was going to get that first down.
I think the Montini fans, they're not booing. They're saying that's an awfully generous spot.
They were saying, ooh.
Ooh, that was close.
They weren't saying boo, ooh.
Under 6 minutes to go now, third quarter. Here we go again. Oh, that's got to be a lonesome feeling for Jeff Hodgen. Throws it down the middle, and they're going to get that interference call they wanted in the first half. I'm not so sure that they should have gotten it that time. It was Howard, the intended receiver.
Yeah, Pat Lyons, I think, got away with a interference earlier in the
pass
game.
Interference.
Here you see right down the
defense.
Field. He goes down. Here's the probe. Pretty decent throw. He's got his right hand on his back, and that is guilty every time. He's not happy about it, but he's lucky he didn't have one earlier in the game. That would be his second. But not bad defense, but just enough to get the call. I think it was a good call, the right call.
I didn't think Howard had that much of a chance of it watching it live, but that's why those guys are officials and
we're up here.
We're up here, right? That was,
they'd probably do our job better than we do their job.
Yeah, I'm sure. 5:32 to go. Oh, again, lonesome Jeff Hodgen. Now he quarterback keeps, takes it out to midfield. He's been playing quarterback since seventh grade, says, I just love it. I love to throw the ball. His line, he gives a lot of credit to his line. They've abandoned him, though, now, haven't they? They're over here on the sidelines.
They're putting a lot of their trust in Mr. Hodgen right now, putting him back there all by himself.
And a false start will bring it back.
Yeah, legal procedure. They may not have had the right guys on the line of scrimmage. Obviously, this is a new offense for Coal City, and that's something that you're prone to make some mistakes when you haven't run this as your
legal
regular
formation.
Offense. Yep.
On the offense, 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
You got to have seven men on the line of scrimmage. Look at Coach Onsen. He's saying we got it, but you got to have seven men on the line of scrimmage, a minimum. You can have more, but you can't have less than seven, and when you do these kind of things, it sometimes screws up your procedure.
That wasn't the same formation as they had before?
They brought him in. They brought a guy in motion. I don't know if that made the difference, but.
Oh, it was a funny shot of Lenny Olsen with his hands up in the air, like, what are you doing to him? First and 15, Watson's in motion this time. Hodgson, the deep drop, ball is tipped before it could get to Howard, who is the intended receiver.
They tried to set up a screen here to Howard. Had it really set up nicely. They had the lineman out there. Here you'll see the drop back by Hodgson does a nice job looking the defense off to the right, coming back to the left for the screen. But Highland goes up, makes a big play. You see the lineman out there ready to block. They had a nicely developing play, but the play by Highland negated it, bringing up second and long again.
It's been tough going for this Coal City offense, and not taking anything away from Montini, but Zach Smith, their leading rusher, played just a couple of plays. Again, he's got a broken thumb. I think it was just to show that he could play, but has not been a factor in this ballgame. Hodgins throw, Watson, the intended man. Good coverage there by Lyons. It was a bit underthrown.
Well, Montini's ability to score and get out ahead has really put Coal City out of their element. I mean, this is not what they do. I mean, Coal City lines up and they're 3, 4, 5 yards a carry. They play good defense and they play field position. And so this is tough duty for Coal City. But they're going to have to make plays through the air to come back in this football game. They've got time. 4:47 left to go in the third. They've got time to do it, but they need to be productive.
Coal City out of the Interstate 8 Conference. Third and 15 here. Hodges pass picked off. That's Mucha at the 30. Now the 20. And he'll be brought down from behind at the 3, make that the 4-yard line. Mike Mucha with the interception, and he brings it back 41 yards.
Hodgen overthrow, had a man open, threw it over his head. Here he comes. Hodgen gets the snap, looks out here to the left, has a man open, but throws it up and over his head, right into the hands of Mucha. Then with that speed, he gets down to the 5-yard, and here's another look at it. The ball floats a little bit. See him wide open, but throws it over his head. Mucha just sits there, waits for it, and makes the play.
And now he takes it in untouched for the score. Mike Mucha, well, there are several schools looking at him, Greg. A couple of them, Michigan State, Miami of Ohio, would like him to play defensive back, and he is a very versatile kid. Northwestern's looking at him as a running back. Wisconsin as a linebacker. He can do a lot of things, and we saw it right there. And Montini will go for the extra point here.
He's got
to try and make it 29-9.
Which is a good combination of speed and size. He can run real well, and he's strong, 217 pounds.
Up and good, and Montini is running away with this one. 29-0 with 4:32 to go here in the third quarter on the IHSA TV network. And a very jubilant Montini sideline. 29-0 the lead for the Broncos. And we've still got 4:32 left in the third quarter. Mike Mucha, there you get a look at him. 110 yards unofficially on the ground, and a big INT for him, and that one's kicked out of bounds, and it'll be a penalty against Montini, and Coal City will start with good field position here, but a pretty monstrous hole down 29-0, not having had any success getting anything going offensively.
Yeah, the turnovers, Montini's done a good job converting their turnovers this third quarter into points. In the first half, on the flip side, Coal City had three turnovers, got 0 points,
legal after procedure.
The turnovers.
Kick the ball out of bounds. First down, Coal City on the 35-yard line.
This game is testing the domino theory as we take a look at the turnovers. Both teams with three tonight. Coal City not able to capitalize. Hodgson gives to Lardy, and not much room there for Lardy. The domino theory, Montini beat Driscoll Catholic. All right, you with me?
Got it.
Driscoll is the only team to beat Wilmington. Wilmington is the only team to beat Coal City, 20-4. So from that standpoint, that reasoning, you would think that Montini would win this game.
But you still got to tee it up.
That's right. That's right. Don't play any of them on paper, do they?
But Wilmington also had two key players that did not. They got hurt in that football game against Driscoll.
Right. Oh, fumble. Hodgson looked like fumbled or just dropped the football, and Lardy jumped on it. How about the football in that? Just that little geographical area up there. Wilmington had a great team this year. Coal City is here. Joliet Catholic and Morris are just a few miles apart. I mean, it's stunning when you think about it, really.
You grow up in that area, you dream about playing football for these teams because they come down and play in games like this. It's an exciting area for high school football in our state.
Third and eight, Hodgson the fake, now throws down the middle. Almost picked up, but Art grabs it away. And he's down at the 42-yard line with a Kohler's first down.
That's a great play by Arndt. Again, he is a good receiver. Nice job looking off here. Come back, a nice strong throw in coverage, but Arndt goes up, takes it away. Nice job. Arndt's a nice big target. Got great hands. We saw it earlier in the game. And he's still playing football. They're not giving up.
23 yards on that completion. He started as a tight end, but Lenny Jonsson liked the mismatch with him as wide receiver. He's so much bigger than the defensive backs. He made a nice play there. Hodgson fakes the handoff. Throws deep down the middle again. A little hand in the back, and that's going to be interference on Montini. Steve Weidecker got a little forearm to the back there on Vickers, and that was definitely interference.
Throwing into coverage a little bit, but right there you see the hit just a little bit too
early.
Yep, timed it a little bit poorly.
Pass interference.
And got the 15-yard penalty.
15-yard penalty, first down.
This is, if not the best field position for Coal City, pretty darn close.
I think they've been across the 50 one time today, Lee. This will be their second time across the 50.
I think you're right. 2:49 left, third quarter. Vickers in motion. Gets the handoff and dragged down from behind. Matt Gertler got a hold of his shoulder pads and just dragged it down.
Yeah, nice. I like that they mixed it up just a little bit for Coal City, not throwing the ball on every single play, because that defensive front from Montini is pinning its ears back now and just coming with everything they got for the sack, and just a little bit of a change of pace there with the run that will help them stop the rush a little bit.
Coal City won the state championship in 1993. Lenny Olson was an assistant coach for that team. Howard in motion. Here's the give to Lardy. He's got a little room and gets down to about the 22-yard line. That'll bring up third down. Lenny Olson, in fact, he is the ultimate Coal City Kohler. He was on the first varsity team back in 1978. Went to college, came back, worked on the chain gangs when he was a college student. came back volunteer assisted. And, you know, here he is leading his alma mater to the state championship game.
Would you say he would have coal in his blood?
He's coal-hearted. Hodgen has a man, Vickers, but he can't hang on. It's incomplete. Good coverage there by Joey Borsellino. Yep.
Good effort, too, by Vickers there. Just couldn't come down with it. We hit the ground. The ball popped loose. Nice protection by the Coal City front five. Hodgen has all day to throw here. Nice job. Steps up nice in the pocket. Throws a strike. Just real good coverage. He's got it. Hits the ground. Pops out. Good effort.
See Vickers well decorated with all the stickers on his helmet there. A minute 25 left, third quarter. Coal City trying to make a dent in that scoreboard.
They come on the blitz here.
Fourth and four. Hodgen complete to Rouse, and he's got a first down. Ben Rouse. 20 receptions on the year coming into tonight. And a big one there on fourth and four.
Nice arm strength here by Hodgen, right to the sideline, knows right where the first down marker is. Nice catch, good effort to dive across to keep the chains moving. First down, Coal City.
First and 10 from the 17. Howard in motion now. Hodgen waves him through, says, hurry up. Hodgen rolls left. Mooch is in pursuit. Hodgen lofts it, and Vickers can't come down with it. Good coverage that time by Joy Borsellino.
There is not a lot of room for those receivers out there. They are playing great coverage. We've seen a couple of pass interference penalties, but I'll tell you what, they are all over the receivers. There's not very big windows for Jeff Hodgen to throw into. He's had time a lot of times, too, during this game. He's been back there looking for receivers, but they're covered. That defensive backfield for Montini is doing a great job.
He had a man coming that time. Hodgen back to throw. Nick Arndt tries to get it. Borsellino knocks it away from Nick Arndt. Nick Arndt is 6'3". Joey Borsellino is listed as 5'6", and he knocked it away from the big guy.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. I think Nick's a little disappointed. He knew that same, he had that height advantage. Jeff Hodgen doesn't get the ball high enough. He just throws it up high like a basketball rebound. It's a touchdown, but he kind of underthrew it and gave a Borsellino a chance to knock it down. If that's thrown high over his shoulder, I think you're looking at 6 points.
Chris Andriano says that Joey Borsellino, pound for pound, is the best football player you'll find. Not a lot of pounds, 5'6", 150, but showed a lot of heart on that play. Here comes a blitz. Hodgen tries it again. Now he overthrows Arndt this time. Borsellino was there. The first one was a little underthrown, and that one was too tall for Nick Arndt.
I think they were talking about the same thing we were on the sidelines. Let's go back to him because he can't guard him, and unfortunately, we just overthrown.
Shouldn't it be Nick isn't? It sounds Arndt. Just bad, like bad isn't. English, you know?
Arndt.
Poor English. Mm-hmm. Nick Arndt. Sorry. We got a chance to talk to him after the game. He's a nice, nice young man and really come up big for this team. Had a 15-yard touchdown reception in the semis. Fourth and 10. And a whistle will blow it dead. No mercy by Montini. They were bringing everybody.
They're bringing the kitchen sink on that one. Caused movement.
Delay of gain.
Prior to the snap. Delay of gain, the offense, 5-yard penalty.
That'll make it a little tougher. Fourth and 15.
Fourth down.
Coal City's going to have any say in this game. It's got to happen now. Hodgen to Arndt.
Great grab.
He makes the catch for the touchdown. 22 yards. Jeff Hodgen and Nick Arndt. And Coal City's on the board.
Great individual effort there by Arndt. We've seen him make great catches all day. He just runs a corner route here. You see Hodgin looking to his right, coming back. He knew all the time, I think he was gonna go to the corner. Way to go up and get it. What a great effort there. Actually good coverage again, but the good pass and catch gives 6 points to Coal City.
Ben Rouse for the point after, 50 of 58 on the year. Beautiful. Up and good. And it's 29-7. Take another look. 18th touchdown pass of the season for Jeffrey Hodgin.
Good protection again on the blitz. They were coming with a lot of guys. Great job of courage stepping up in the pocket, delivering a strike to Nick Arndt. Goes up and gets it. You're not going to see a better catch on Sundays. I mean, that's a great play hit by a high school football player.
Makes it 29-7, and when I went to Coal City last week and watched this team play and saw Nick Arndt play, I wrote leaper with an exclamation point because he makes catches like that all the time for Coal City.
Well, he's going to have to make a few more of them in the fourth quarter for them to come back to this in this game.
And Jeff Hodgin, you talked about them kind of having to get out of character and throw a little bit more than they're used to. Jeff Hodgin in the playoffs only had 16 incompletions in four playoff games prior to tonight.
Right. Well, he's been one of the main reasons. I asked Coach Hutchins, their offensive coordinator, who was the key to their offense. You know, was it, Matt Watson or Kyle Lardy? Who was it? They immediately said Jeff Hodgin. He said he's been the difference for them down the stretch in these playoffs.
Comments or questions for us? Compliments, we hope. TV@IHSA.org. And kudos to Mr. Jim O'Boy and our director, Frank Vance, and all the great crew here on hand, bringing you 8 football games in 2 days. They do a great job. That one kicked through the end zone with 56 seconds left here in the third quarter.
Lee, really, you're only down 3 scores. You can score 3 times. They're going to get 3 possessions between now and the end of the game. Coal City should not be giving up. They got to stay in the game. Their defense is their strength. They've got to try to maybe get a turnover and a quick score. It's not out of the question. You can come back. But you've got to play good defense, maybe get a turnover or get some 3 and outs.
When you're only allowing 4 points a game, though, is your defense maybe reeling a little bit? And can they get back on their feet and make a stand here?
Right. They need a turnover. It would be really, really helpful for their emotion.
Here's Mucha. It's whistled dead before the play is off. That's usually not good news for the offense.
This is the
prior to the snap, dead ball foul, false start, offense, 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
This is the time of the game when your leaders need to take over. They have to get in there, and they're going to have to make great plays. They're going to get in the huddle and say, hey, guys, let's not quit. And you look to your seniors at this time in the game.
Here's Andriano looking on, hoping his offense can keep Coal City from getting back in this game and eat a little time here. Borsellino right up the middle, then breaks to the right. He's got room to run at the 40, now the 50. Look at him go. Only one man can catch him. He steps inside and is brought down by Vickers at the 5 after an 80-yard run. He could go all the way, but he didn't.
Here's the play right here. Very simple, just a dive straight up the gut. Borsellino gets to the outside. Then you'll see Murphy doing a great job. You see the speed of Murphy coming here to make a block. He runs right past Borsellino, actually. You can't see him, just in the corner of your screen there. And then we have a cutback right here. Use this leg. The old tripping play. Hey, use your whole body, whatever it takes.
Vickers came from out of nowhere to get him. And that is 1 yard shy of the longest run in a 4A title game. Here's Borsellino again. He gets a couple of yards. The record for 4A title game, longest rush, 81 yards by Scott Kinsella of Joliet Catholic way back in 1978.
You gotta love that, Coach Andriano. The guy goes 80 yards, he's exhausted. Who's he giving to on the next play? Borsellino, give it to him again.
Wants him to get the touchdown, yeah.
Here he is. Good look
we
at
played
him.
Three, we played three quarters. He's gassed. Refuel, brother. 29-7. Back after these local messages. Twelve minutes to play here. Lombard Montini with a 29-7 lead and 3 yards from another score after an 80-yard run by Joey Borsellino. Yeah, Coach Adriano wanted that young man to get a touchdown.
Yeah, he did.
All right, you just ran 80. All right, keep at it till you get into the end zone. Joey Borsellino, his 14th touchdown of the season. 811 yards on the year coming into tonight's ball game, and Grandma Tootsie is watching. I don't know if she's here or if she's back home, but she's excited about that. She's got two grandsons about to win a state championship here tonight and have two more go for a state championship tomorrow. Pat Lyons on for the extra point. Skip to Dobry, picks it up, and all he does is run it in. I remember last year we did the Driscoll Catholic game. Maybe it was a couple of years ago. No, it was last year, I think. And just everything they did was right. And that's what this kind of reminds me of. 37-7 after the two-point conversion. Back with more on the IHSA TV network. The score. Montini with the seemingly insurmountable lead here tonight. This copyrighted broadcast presented for the entertainment and non-commercial use of our audience. Any reproduction or other use of this program without the express written consent of the Illinois High School Association and cost broadcast sales is strictly prohibited. Jeff Farnell kicks it off for the Broncos. One hops it through the end zone, and it's about the only thing Howard didn't get his hands on tonight. He's got a couple of INTs. And that one just, that's like a bad hop single through the infield.
Jeff Hodgen throws a pretty hard ball. That ball was going twice as fast. That ball was flying.
And we discussed it in the break, and you were right. That was 2 years ago for Driscoll Catholic, and that was against Mount Carmel when they could do no wrong.
41-0, I think.
And it was so highly anticipated because it was a rematch of those two teams from the previous year, and they had had a pretty good battle
overtime,
in the state championship game.
It's a great overtime game.
Lardy, yellow shoes and all, up to the 30-yard line, close to a first down.
Gain of 11, it's a first down for Cole City at the 31-yard line.
Well, the Suburban Catholic, the teams that come out of there as the conference championship usually have a good opportunity to get down. They have so many good teams in their league. They play great competition, and they bang up on each other. Then when they survive and come out of there for the playoffs, they're usually battle ready. And we've seen that with Driscoll down here the last 3 years and now Montini this year.
Hodgen on first down. Nick Arndt close to another first down. Well, they have a real chance to make some hay while the sun shines here this weekend. The Suburban Catholic Conference this weekend has a chance to make it six titles in 4 years. Now, you can run those down for us. Driscoll Catholic has three straight.
Right.
Who else?
Immaculate Conception won last year, and then you've got Montini this year. And if Driscoll wins again this year, that's six in the last 4 years out of the same conference.
Outstanding.
2 years in a row, they could have two teams from their conference winning state championships in two divisions.
Hodgen down the middle to Howard. He got shellacked there. Matt Neustadt knocked it loose. Well, and of course, that creates some controversy when, you know, there's a lot of talk and a lot of action going on behind the scenes. They're looking at ways to maybe even the field a little more. Some say that Catholic schools win too many, private schools win too many state championships.
That has been discussed for many, many years among the coaching ranks in our state. The best teams win. you know, and you still got to come play football. And there's plenty of great public teams that win championships. We had Sterling Newman Catholic win in 2A. And looks like we're headed for another one here. And we've got Driscoll Catholic in our 4A, or excuse me, in our 3A state championship game. And we got Joliet Catholic in 5A.
Against Morris tomorrow.
And we got Providence in 6A. So they're
against
well represented. Yep, they're well represented here. They play good football. I mean, there's not much more you can say.
Yeah, and you can look at it. You know, you can look at it a different way. If you want to read a good column on with a different point of view, Kirk Wessler, the editor of the Peoria Journal Star, did a great column a week or so ago about that subject. Completion to Arndt. He's out of bounds at the 45-yard line, and I can see where people say that. And but then you can't. Then are you going to go into other sports and say, okay, for example, from my area, Peoria, Emanuel, Peoria Central have won an inordinate amount of state championships over the last 10 years. Are you going to? How are you going to even? You know, you can't, how are you going to even that out?
Right.
And then you're gonna, then you're talking about Elmhurst, York, I believe, in cross country, and then right. There are other teams that are swimming powers. And
sure.
You, how are you going to balance all that out? And go to pjstar.com and read Kirk Wessler's column. It was a different take on it. I kind of thought it was. He made some good points there as that pass by Hodgen is incomplete.
Well, one thing I would not like to see is like what they do up in Wisconsin. They have a Catholic champion. They have a whole Catholic and private school championship series, and then they have the public school championship series. I don't really like that at all. I like to see everybody in the state compete against one another. Maybe they could do some things to make it more even. Maybe they used to do. You had to play up a little bit. The Catholic schools had to play up in class. And it's a debate that's gone on for a long time in the state of Illinois. But you take nothing away from these teams that come and win.
No, absolutely not. It's, you know, it's a thing that's still under discussion. The IHSA is looking into it, looking to try and, I don't know if even out is the right way to put it, as Vickers makes the catch near midfield. But it's, you know, it brings a lot of passion to the, you know, passions bubble up when you bring up this subject. And, you know, there's a lot of passion on both sides. And,
sure.
You know. I'm not smart enough to come up with a solution to it, I'll just admit it. But, you know, you want things to be fair now. I mean, and the IHSA has come down hard on schools that have been recruiting,
sure.
For example, in basketball. That pass is incomplete by Hodgen on 3rd and 6. You look at... I believe it was the coach at Hales Franciscan. He kind of admitted in the media that he had been looking at a player, and he had to sit for the year. There's the prep bowl. Brother Rice over Lane Tech, 35-14. Us downstaters don't know what the heck that's all about. That's all yours.
it's an opportunity for teams that don't come down here, and they get an opportunity to play in the Chicago Championship is basically what that is.
Okay.
In public and private schools. It's been done for years and years and years. It's a great tradition within Chicago football. It's the 75th meeting for the public and private schools. Yep, good effort on 4th down.
He went a long way to gain a yard. And that'll turn it over on downs. And they've taken control of this game a long time ago. 37-7, our score with 9:20 to go here.
Got some new guys in the game here. Got a new quarterback.
Uh-oh. Now we're going to have to work some more.
That's Pete Capetta there, quarterback.
Still Mucha and Borsellino in the backfield, though. And the quarterback keeper for Capetta. Gets his name in the scorebook. It's about 4 yards. Martis brings him down.
Capetta's only a sophomore getting an opportunity to play here. They're obviously grooming him for the future. And these teams in this conference, they don't rebuild, they just reload, and he's probably the guy for the future here. Giving him opportunity to play with the first team.
whistle down. Peter Kenny with the carry there. He's a junior reserve running back, comes in a lot.
Here comes Mucci out of the game, great career. Going to cap it off with a state championship ring.
He's got more athletics ahead of him. He's a outstanding wrestler. Second at state last year, and he's been a part of three dual team wrestling titles in a row for the Montini wrestling team. And he's also made it to state in track, was a member of a couple of relay teams a year ago.
You don't like to see lopsided games, but one thing this does allow is for everybody on both sides to get into the football game. A lot of times too, what happens, particularly at the lower levels here, the 4A and below, is you get a lot of the freshmen, even some, you know, sophomores and freshmen that come up, they're able to suit up at a state championship game. They get to play on the field here, on the turf. It's exciting for them.
That's Brad Blackwell, the linebacker. And backup running back. He might be featured in this Montini offense next year. He gets a carry that time and comes off. He likes to deliver the hits, not so sure he likes to take them.
It's like a tackling dummy when you're running. You have to be the hitter, not the hittee.
Exactly. Petta keeps it himself. Look at him go at the 20, and he's gone. Pete Capetta, 38-yard touchdown run for the backup sophomore quarterback for Lombard Montini. And Mucci will drink to that.
Excitement, a big hug from his the guy he replaced, Dobry, gave him a big hug on the way out.
Pat Lyons on for the extra point.
Pat Lyons has a nice leg. You'll see it here on this kick. He can get a hold of it. Oh, and he didn't. See what I know? Last time, boy, he got a hold of it.
6:46 left, it's 44-7, back in Champaign on the IHSA TV network. And we're back, all Montini in this game, 44-7, the Broncos dominant in this 4A state championship game. Jeff Farnell will kick it off. And that will sail into the end zone, where Brandon Howard gets the touchback. Our officials, we haven't mentioned them, all from the Chicagoland area. Jim Bernardi, Richard Klein, Paul Black, Frank Moscardini Sr., and Mark Thompson. And a little pat on the back for them. Congratulations for being assigned to the championship game this weekend. It's a big honor for them to be down here.
They've done a good job, too.
And I know the IHSA is...
there they are.
There right they there. Are.
Good-looking group of men.
Oh, yeah.
Got a rookie, Jim Bernardi.
How about
actually,
that?
He would be the referee with the white
oh,
hat.
Oh, I thought he was Republican. I didn't
okay.
know.
It is blue.
That's true. Watson gets the handoff. And he lowers his shoulder and gets out across the 25-yard line. And a tough way for the Coal City Kohlers to wind up a season. After a great year, 12-1, they almost ran the table in the regular season before losing to Wilmington in that regular season finale, and then made this run to the state championship for the first time since 1993. There's Zach Smith back in there.
just was unfortunate for them today. They got behind early, and that it's something that they really don't want to do. They want to play that ball control and keep the ball for a lot of time on the clock, and they just didn't get an opportunity with the weapons that Montini has, a couple of long runs, and they made some, particularly second half here with those turnovers, really put them at a disadvantage and put them behind, and they had to throw the football, and it's just not what they do best.
Jack Carpenter, backup quarterback, now in for the Kohlers. And he gives to Smith, and not much room there for Zach Smith, who's just a sophomore. Lenny Olson says he's the second, or says his bench press is 300 pounds plus as a sophomore. That's pushing some weight around.
You know, the teams that get down here are the teams that do the work, and not only do they do the little things like work on their throwing and their catching and running and all that, they do hit those weights and get physical and use that strength, and that makes a big difference.
City bringing a great crowd here today. And obviously disappointed with the way things are turning out here. There's Mike Kleff. Let's go down and talk to him. Is that Tootsie?
All right, Lee and Greg, thank you very much. And this is 73-year young Dorothy Andriano, the mother of head coach of Montini, Chris Andriano, and the grandmother of assistant coach Matt Andriano. And Dorothy, what's going through your mind right now?
I can't believe it. First of all, Grandpa passed away 9 years ago, and it would just be wonderful for him to be here. I mean, we put a flagpole up at Montini, and it was in his honor. And it says, to the memory of Joseph Andriano, you know, it's wonderful.
Dorothy, congratulations tonight. Enjoy it.
Thank you.
Dorothy Andriano, the mother of head coach Chris Andriano. One more time.
I'm so proud of these guys. They did a wonderful job.
You should be. Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you.
What a great night for the Andriano family. Lee and Greg.
You bet. Congratulations to them. Chris Andriano, Hall of Fame coach, his first time ever in the state championship game. And he's going to take home the big prize here tonight. Back to Lombard. We got a chance to see Mike Mucha, 100. How many yards you got in for, Dave? Dave Berkson, our statistician, 192 yards unofficially. We're probably going to see him play somewhere on Saturdays. Now, Coach Andriano says maybe Miami of Ohio is his pick right now, the leader at least. But
that'd be a great place.
Some Big Ten schools looking at him as well. Sun-Times Little School Player of the Year.
Not only did he do it with his offense, but defensively,
right.
He made that big. That's probably the defensive play of the game. We probably may show that. Oh, that might be a fumble.
Picked up by Howard, but they're whistling it down.
I think that's going to be, did he not touch that ball?
He must not have touched it.
It looked like he did from up here. We're discussing it a little bit here, our crew. They are going to, ball was touched, it is Montini's ball.
Well, they're gonna say when Howard touched it, he bounded it, but it was not touched by a Montini player. We also saw Joey Borsellino. He had that big 80-yard gain. He's an all-stater for the High School Coaches Association. Sun-Times. Now, Brandon Fry did not make all-conference, the big lineman, but he is an all-stater as well as a junior. Another new quarterback, Kane Kiernan.
Lee, he's a freshman. So, well, they're getting ready for their next, they're reloading for when Capetta's gone. Now they got the freshman. As we were just saying, the neat thing about a game like this, you can't get everybody in. And
right. Something they won't ever forget. You never know when you'll get back again. You may not. Kiernan keeps it himself and brought down across the 40-yard line. Right. Up next, it's another Suburban Catholic Conference team. Driscoll Catholic taking on Bureau Valley. The Storm regulars in Class A basketball in Peoria at the Class A state championships in basketball. They make a trip tonight in football. That's up next here on the IHSA TV network. Oh, and a big tackle there. Sean Brooks, another reserve in there with a nice tackle.
And Bureau Valley, the only team to beat our 2A state champion, Sterling Newman Central Catholic, and obviously Driscoll from the same conference as Montini. Montini won by two touchdowns in their game against Driscoll, which was kind of the coronation of Montini as this year's team. I think that's going to be a good football game here tonight at 7. I'm looking forward to that game.
Montini will punt. That snap almost got away from him. Turner had a hand on it, dropped it, and now had to chase it back down.
Uh-oh. They're diluting the Gatorade so it doesn't get too sticky. Here it comes. We got to have the telestrator. Where's the telestrator? Madden would be all over it. I'm not as good as John Madden, but there's a lot of scheming going on.
Guys are looking for Chris Andriano, too.
This shows unity, how well they can pull this off as a team. They got to hide it. See, there's got to be guys that are kind of hiding it in front.
Right.
Yeah, they have it. Good job.
Lenny Olson got his first Gatorade shower last week for Coal City in the semifinals, and Chris Andriano is going to get a state championship shower here in moments.
They're patient, and they're gathering around.
That's Zach Smith again with the carry for Coal City. Chris Andriano being embraced on the sidelines.
Yep, they're giving him a hug. Oh! There it is. There was deception in that, Lee.
Yeah, but Frank Gentile, big lineman, had to take a bullet, too.
He
saw a little bit of that.
I think it was worth it. They sent the big guy up for the hug to block it off.
That's right.
And then over his shoulder came the Gatorade.
Chris Andriano, we spoke with him on the phone earlier this week for about a half hour. He's a soundbite machine, a delight to talk to, and our congratulations to him and this Montini team. Congratulations to Coal City for getting here. I always just feel for those teams that come away with the second place trophy.
Yeah,
it's a great accomplishment, and you know, it's tough tonight. Somewhere down the road, they'll look back and be glad they were here. It's a tough one to swallow tonight, I'm sure.
You just have high expectations. You've played good football all the way through. You don't even perceive yourself losing, let alone getting beat kind of like the Coal City is getting beat tonight. So it's tough tonight, but tomorrow morning I think they'll realize what kind of season they had and the memories that they created as a team. They'll never forget their run to the state championship game.
Lenny Olson bringing his alma mater to the state championship game, and he definitely did not envision this kind of an ending for his team. Chris Andriano adds to that Hall of Fame resume here tonight. He's already in the Hall of Fame, 26 years as head coach, the only head coaching job he's ever had. The Montini fans count it down. And it's a state championship for Chris Andriano and the Montini Broncos. Down to Mike Cliff.
All right, thank you very much, Lee and Greg. We are live here, Chris Andriano. We interviewed your mom just a couple of moments ago. She said if your dad were here tonight, he would be so thrilled.
Yeah, he would. He was an awesome guy. He loved Montini football. He was our number one fan for, I don't know, as long as he was alive when I was at Montini's, 31 years, so. He's proud right now, and I'm proud to be an Andriano.
And your son's an assistant coach, and I can tell by the hugging of your players that these players are so special.
Well, these kids have worked. They've worked very hard for this, and they deserve what they're able to enjoy right now. This is a great group of kids, and Montini is very proud of these guys.
Chris, I know it's just been a few seconds since the final gun went off. Has this sunk in?
Yeah, it has. I feel real good right now, even with this cold shower.
We'll let you go enjoy. Congratulations, Chris.
Very much. Thank you.
All right. Montini, a winner, 44-7. We're going to try to find Mike Mucha, the player of the game. Maybe we'll find Matt Andriano as well. For now, we'll send it back up to Lee and Greg.
All right, Mike, thanks a lot. Today, I consider myself, okay. We're on the loudspeaker here in the stadium for a little bit and just having a little fun there. 44-7, the final, a jubilant Montini crowd here tonight, enjoying their first ever football state championship.
It's well deserved. They really played a good football game tonight. Really, offensively, defensively, special teams, all three facets of the game, they really played well, probably outplayed Coal City in each facet of the game tonight. Coal City did a nice job first half, staying within it, 15 points, 15-0 at halftime. They survived a few things, but just didn't have enough offense tonight to compete.
Let's go back downstairs to Mike.
Thanks, Lee. Thanks, Greg. Player of the game, Mike Mucha. Mike, it's been just a few seconds. Are you just numb right now?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great feeling. We had a total team effort today. I think our whole team played great, and I'm just feeling great right now.
I know it was a decisive victory, Mike, but getting that score first early on, like you guys have done this season, that had to be big.
Yeah, we take a lot of pride in getting the first score and setting the tone for the rest of the game. And our special teams made some big plays in our offense, and we came out and we got the momentum right off the bat.
Mike, Coach Andriano, what do you think is going through his mind right now? What does it mean to get him his first state title?
It's just awesome. You know, I'm so happy for him. He this is his whole life. You know, he works so hard at this, and I couldn't be happier for him. I love him.
How great of a coach is he, bottom line?
He's the best.
All right.
Mike Mucha, congratulations to player of the game.
Thank you.
Mike Mucha, the state champion 4A Montini Broncos. What a performance. Lee, Greg, back to you guys upstairs.
192 yards for Mike Mucha and a state championship for the Montini Broncos. And there you see a little bit of the celebration going on. They are headed down to the end zone area for the trophy presentation, which we'll bring you just here in just a moment as you see Pat Lyons, the kicker and defensive back, getting a hug on the way to pick up the big hardware. And not so excited, the Coal City Coalers. Big coal mining town back in the 1860s. That was a town of about 10,000 way back when. Not quite that big now, but they take a lot of pride in their football, as well they should. 1993 state champs and a runner-up trophy here tonight, and that's something to be very proud of.
This is one of the greatest moments in sports when you get an opportunity after you've spilled everything on the field to accept the winner's championship trophy. There's nothing like high school football, playing with your friends. You grow up with them. They're your buddies in grade school, junior high, and you've spent so much time together, and then you have a moment like this in your athletic career to celebrate together all the memory. It all comes to a head in this great, exciting thing of stepping up onto this stand. It's tough for second place, but again, as time goes on, they're going to appreciate this, and particularly then for Montini, what a great moment it is for those captains to stand up there. You see here them accepting the medals around their neck. They wish they were gold rather than silver. But again, great effort by all these young men. Great team. Again, they weren't the most explosive offensively, but together they played fantastic defense all year. There was probably not many better defenses in all of the eight classes than this Coal City defense this year. And they had a tough time tonight with Montini. But congratulations to them. Great job.
It tells you what kind of year they had. They only allowed one 100-yard rusher all year, and that was in the final game of the regular season, Tony Verselli from Wilmington. And then on the flip side of that, to see what Mike Mucha and Montini did tonight, Mike Mucha, 192 yards, almost doubled that by his output.
Borsellino had close to 100 yards as well. So they had two guys that were over 100 yards.
And Mucha, at 192 yards, wasn't far off the Class 4A title game record of 213 by John Martin of New Lenox Providence in 1987, sure. 213 yards. So.
And he certainly could have broke it if this wasn't a blowout right. game. I mean, he didn't play at all, really, in the fourth quarter.
Let's take a look at our defensive play of the game.
Well, here it is, number 33, overthrow. Oh, no, it's the other interception. We had two interceptions on the evening. This was an interception right here by number 9. Steve Erlenbaugh was a big play in that game right at the outset of the third quarter. Helped change the momentum.
And our defensive play of the game brought to us by the Illinois National Guard. A great defensive effort, too. Let's not forget to give some kudos to the Montini defense, too,
sure.
holding Cole City to the 7 points tonight.
Yeah, all year they really have been overshadowed by the powerful offense. But as you mentioned, improvement game by game. And they showed tonight that they are a defense that can make big plays and do what's needed to stop opponent offenses.
All right, we talked about that. And Chris Andriano kind of calls it his no-name defense. They went to the 4-3 this year. They used to play the 5-2. He felt he didn't have a dominant linebacker, so he went to the 5-2. And after that slow start where they gave up 29.5 points per game in the first four. The last nine games, Chris Andriano's defense only allowed 9.5 points a game and only allowed 7 here tonight. And he gives a big pat on the back to his defensive coordinator, Mike Bukowski, for getting that straightened out. And we see the gold medals coming out for the Broncos, who finished the year 13-1. Cole City finishes 12-2, representing the Interstate 8 here tonight in the 4A state championship game. And there's the big prize.
As the snow begins to fall.
...44-7 the final tonight. The Montini Broncos, number one in Class 4A.
There was just a picture. We had I saw one in the stands, a picture in the stands of the Pope.
Pope Paul VI, John Baptist Montini.
There it is.
Was his name. There he is.
Yep, there it is. There's the picture.
And Montini High School, that's Pope
John Paul. They were looking for divine help tonight.
Ah, they got it. Don't know that they needed it.
No.
And there we are from high above Memorial Stadium. Happy Thanksgiving to you and yours, and hope you enjoyed tonight's high school football championship game, the 3A championship game, coming up next after these local messages.
Welcome back to Memorial Stadium. It's the first day of the state high school football finals. We've had three games completed, one still to go. Just a quick recap. In the first game of the day in 2A, Newman Catholic defeated Carthage. In the second game in 1A, it was the Red Storm of Alexis United knocking off Stockton. And in the most recently finished game, Chris Andriano wins his first state title as head coach of the Montini Broncos as they defeat the Kohlers of Cole City. Now, joining us live, and we appreciate it, another gentleman from the IHSA, and that would be Anthony Holman. And bottom line, Anthony, so far so good, you'd have to say, after three games.
Yeah, we've been pretty excited with the level of competition and the excitement of the fans and the production of our TV staff. So we're really happy with the way how things have going so far.
Of course, Anthony is one of the assistant executive directors with the IHSA. Anthony, first and foremost, this weekend, what is your main responsibility here?
I'm really the liaison for our media and our TV network, helping with our stats crew and just our overall presentation of the event throughout the weekend. Dave Ganaway is our administrator for football, but we help him with just kind of the presentation of how things are packaged and presented to our fans.
Hey, Anthony, us TV guys in the media, we work pretty hard, don't we?
You do a great job. You do a great job.
No, thanks. Hey, Anthony, one thing about this, and it's so big as part of the media coverage,
of high school sports. I mean, it's a great way to spread the product. And what you have to realize, Anthony, I'm sure you do, is it's not just television, but in this day and age, it's everything, and that includes the internet, doesn't it?
Oh, you're absolutely right. We've been fortunate enough to get with a company called Amerisports, and they do our internet broadcast. So folks that aren't able to watch this, or we've got some folks that we've received emails from that are overseas that have an opportunity to listen to their younger brother or cousin or nephew play in a state championship over the via the internet. So that's been a great thing. Technology's an awesome thing for us, and we've got we just have to give kudos to the media and the coverage that we've received. They've been very helpful and very supportive of our young people.
We're talking with Anthony Holman, one of the assistant executive directors for the IHSA. And Anthony, after three games this weekend, we have five left, one tonight, four more tomorrow. How would you grade yourself so far? I'd give you an A.
Well, we take an A. we always want to strive for an A+, but so far so good. We lost Jim Flynn, who had been with our staff for over 30 years, to retirement just this past year, and trying to pick up the pieces of some of the things that that Jim took care of is just going to be there's a slight learning curve there, but Jim's been really good in helping us to kind of figure out some of the things and find our way, but we're appreciative of the folks and ask everybody to be patient. If there are some kinks, we certainly want to work through those, and we're looking to have some great football tonight and tomorrow, some great matchups as well.
Hey, Anthony, I'd echo your thoughts on Jim Flynn. He's always been good to us, great to us, as a matter of fact, and one of the really, really good people in the state of Illinois. Anthony Holman, one of the assistant executive directors of the IHSA, thanks for joining us. Appreciate you taking the time. Hey, we've got more stuff to do. We've got another game to talk about, and we'll do that right after we hear from these local sponsors.